The following information is accurate to our knowledge and is not intended to be against any individual. Our hope on this program is to present the truth as it is in Jesus and invite you to be a noble Berean and study these things for yourself.
Are we teaching the truth in love? Commandments, he knew every single one. Jesus said there's something that indeed he did lack. The Savior told the truth, he didn't hold the message back. He was teaching the truth in love, telling it like it is. Holding pure motives and showing that he cared, he was teaching the truth in love. A woman caught in evil and without an alibi, the truth so very obvious, made no attempt to lie. With all the foes against her, how she felt so all alone, till Jesus asked the people who would throw the first stone. He was teaching the truth in love, telling it like it is. Holding pure motives and showing that he cared, he was teaching the truth in love.
the Soul Cafe studio in South Florida, this is the Antidote to Deception radio program, enlightening the earth with God's truth. And now to the studio and today's word.
Hello, friends, and welcome to the Antidote to Deception Internet Radio. On today's presentation, we are looking at most important aspect of our study going so far. This is part 7 of our series, Are We There Yet? And as we shall see, some things just tell us how close we are to that pivotal point in Earth's history. As those of you saw who were paying attention, there is a parental advisory attached to this podcast because of some of the subject matter which will be discussed in a few minutes. So that section of the program is under a parental advisory, and when it airs, I will let you know again to be advised. So at this time, I invite you to join me as we have a word of prayer before we get into our scripture reading and step away for our theme song. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies towards us. Thank you for being to us a God like no other. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we give you all the praise, honor, and glory that you so richly deserve. Kind Father, this morning, we just want to say thank you for loving us. Thank you for being there for us. Thank you for everything that you do for us, O Lord God. Lord, as we will discuss on this program things that are of a sensitive nature, dear Lord God, I pray that you will give us hearts, Lord God, to endure these things. Lord, help us to understand, again, as was mentioned in the disclaimer, that we're not against individuals, O Lord God, but the systems, the confusion, O Lord God, of this world, the Antichrist power that is to be reared up in these last days. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that your people would understand, especially those who are part of that apostate communion, that you love them, and that you are calling them out of the darkness before it is too late. O Lord Jesus, bless your words to our hearts, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture reading today is taken from Revelation chapter 10, verses 10 and 11, which is our theme scripture for this 30-part series. The Bible says, "And I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it up, and it was in my mouth sweet as honey, and as soon as I had eaten it, my belly was bitter. And he said unto me, Thou must prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings." Beloved, just because we have not explored that scripture reading in a while, remember we said, starting from our first episode, and as I said before, please make time to go back and review some of the content from the previous episodes as you'll be caught up as we continue and go forward. Number one, that prophecy began to be unfolded in the mid-1800s, where there was a movement around the world, people studying on the second advent of Christ. And in the autumn of 1844, that bitter disappointment hit that the prophecy talks about. But their work was not over, as many of them supposed. It had only just begun. And now we see the culmination in these last days of that movement, where the servant of the Lord was told to take the little book. That little book, of course, we talked about being the book of Daniel, and its prophetic understanding began to be unfolded here in what the Bible called in the last days, the last times. Men are indeed shining with the glory and understanding of the Lord, and prophecy is unfolding. I pray that as you continue to be a noble Berean, as we said in our disclaimer, that you will come away knowing for sure, knowing for certain that these things are so, and that you have not followed cunningly devised fables.
Please take a few seconds to support the channel. See the info in the description.
Years of time have come and gone since I first heard it told how Jesus would come again someday. It seems so real, then I just can't help but feel how much closer His coming is today. Signs of the time are ever come again. But the word of God is true. He'll redeem His chosen few. Don't lose hope. Soon Christ Jesus will be saved. Signs of
And now, our segment that is under the parental advisory. So for the next 5 minutes, this program is under a parental advisory. Please take note.
Soul just as clean as any child could be. I say that because sometimes we hear a lot of things that are really not true. Now, after we become the spouse of Jesus Christ, I want you to listen carefully to this, and then you can follow me into the rest of the testimony. We are now looked upon as married women. We are looked upon as married women. We are the spouse or the bride of Jesus Christ. Now, the priest teaches every little girl that will take the white veil, they'll become the bride of Christ. He teaches her to believe that her family will be saved. It doesn't make any difference how many banks they rob, how many stores they rob. It doesn't make any difference how they drink and smoke and carouse and live out in this sinful world and do all the things that sinners do. It doesn't make a bit of difference. Still, our family will be saved if we continue to live in the convent and give our life to the convent or to the church. We can rest assured that every member of our immediate family will be saved. And you know, there are many of little children that are influenced and enticed to go into convents because we realize it is a salvation for our families. And sometimes, even Roman Catholic families, the children grow up and leave the Roman Catholic Church and go out into the deepest of sin. And so every little girl that enters a convent is hoping, by her sacrificing so much, home and loved ones, mother and daddy, everything that a child loves, her family will be saved regardless of what sins they commit. And of course, we're children and our minds are immature and we don't know any better. And it's so easy to instill things like this into the hearts and minds of little children. And the priest is really good at it. And of course, we look upon our priest, our father confessor. I looked upon him as God. He's the only God I knew anything about. And to me, he was infallible. I didn't think he could sin. I didn't think that he would lie. I didn't think that he ever made a mistake. I looked upon him as the holiest of holy because I didn't know a God, but I did know the Roman Catholic priest. And to me, I looked to him for everything that I asked of any of God, so to speak. I believed the priest could give it to me. And so the day comes when all of us. Now, as we're going in, I want you to listen carefully. After taking the white veil, things are beautiful. I'm 16 and a half years of age. Everyone's good to me. And I'm living in the convent, and I haven't seen anything yet. Because no little girl, we are not subject to a Roman Catholic priest until we're 21 years of age. And as we give you this next vow, then you'll understand that we don't know about this. This is kept from the little sisters until we've taken our black veil. And then it's too late. I don't carry the keys to those double doors. And there's no way for me to come out. The priest will tell all over the whole United States and other countries that sisters, or nuns rather, can walk out of convents when they want to. I spent 22 years there. I did everything there was to do to get out. I've carried tablespoons with me into the dungeons and tried to dig down into that dirt because there's no floors in those places. But I never yet found myself digging far enough to get out of a convent with a tablespoon, and that's about the only instrument. Because when we're using the spade, and we do have to do hard, heavy work, when we use a spade, we're being guarded, we're being watched by two older nuns, and they're going to report on it. And I'll assure you, you're not going to try to dig out with a spade, and you wouldn't get very far anyway, because they made those convents or built those convents so little nuns cannot escape. That was their purpose in building them as they build them. And there's no way for us to get out unless God makes a way. But I believe God's making a way for numbers of little girls after they come out of the convents. All right, now when the time comes, I think I was 18 when the mother began talking to me. Now, I planned to come out, see, after my white veil. I wanted to be a little nursing sister in the Roman church. But the Mother Superior, I suppose she was watching my life. I suppose she realized I had much endurance. I had a strong body. And I believe the woman was watching me because one day she asked me to come into her office and she began to tell me, Charlotte, you have a strong body. And she said, I believe you have the possibilities of making a good nun, a cloister nun. I believe you're the type that would be willing to give up home, give up mother and daddy, give up everything you love out in the world, and the world, so to speak, and hide yourself away behind convent doors. Because I believe you're the kind who would hide back there and be willing to sacrifice and live in crucial poverty that you might pray for lost humanity. She said, I believe you're the kind to be willing to suffer because we are taught to believe as nuns that we, as we suffer, our loved ones and your loved ones that are already in a priest purgatory will be delivered from purgatory sooner because of our suffering. She knew I was willing to suffer. I didn't murmur. I didn't complain. She knew all of that, and she's watching my life, and that's the reason she began to tell me about the black veil. And then, of course, you know, I didn't know too much about a cloistered nun. I didn't know their life. I didn't know how they live. I didn't know what they'd done. But, you know, this woman proceeded to tell me. Now, we hear a lot of people try to tell me in the various places that we travel and go. I hear a lot of Roman Catholics try to tell me I've been in so many cloisters. I know all about them. But you know, a Roman Catholic can lie to you, and they don't have to go to confession and tell the priest about the lie that they told because they're lying to protect their faith. They can tell any lie they want to protect their faith and never go to the confessional box and tell the priest about it. They can do more than that.
That's just a piece of over an hour of audio that you will hear by going to the description area of this podcast and clicking on that link. The complete testimony of Sister Charlotte, a former nun in the Roman Catholic Church, who 2 years after this audio was leaked, she ended up dead. Dear listener, understand that the people who put that audio together were from a ministry that was based out of Jamaica, West Indies, and they flooded the island with that audio in 1992, prior to Pope John Paul II's arrival. And you know what? According to the reports, he canceled his trip to Jamaica. The work was done. The message was spread. And I believe, brethren, if so-called Protestant America was on the ball like that, that this apostasy, this Babylonian, this harlotry would not ever have gained sway in the United States. But as we discussed on previous programs, it's not the papacy that changed, as we'll see in our reading today from Great Controversy, chapter 35. Dear listener, I want you to understand that this experience that you just heard a few minutes of, and when you go to the link, you'll get the full scoop of it, is a modern day experience, and we've talked about once from history that Rome does not change, and given the opportunity to do these things again, it will happen. You heard her, a nun that was behind the cloister walls and experienced these things. Imagine, as they say, the half had not been told. I don't know about you, but after listening to that, I need a release. I need an escape. I need a hiding place. How about you? Let's pause, and then we'll come back with our reading for today from the book, The Great Controversy. We're in chapter 35. And as we listen, just remember, God is on our side. Who can be against us?
Please take a few seconds to support the channel. See the info in the description.
You're my hiding place, safe in.
Revelation 18, verses 1 to 4 says, "And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues." Revelation chapter 18, verses 1 to 4. Reading from The Great Controversy, page chapter 35, and page 570, paragraph 2, where we begin, it says, "Christ gives no example in his life for men and women to shut themselves in monasteries in order to become fitted for heaven. He has never taught that love and sympathy must be repressed. The Savior's heart overflowed with love. The nearest man approaches to moral perfection, the keener are his sensibilities, the more acute is his perception of sin, and the deeper his sympathy for the afflicted. The Pope claims to be the vicar of Christ, but how does his character bear comparison with that of our Savior? Was Christ ever known to consign men to the prison or the rack because they did not pay him homage as the King of Heaven? Was his voice heard condemning to death those who did not accept him? When he was slighted by the people of a Samaritan village, the Apostle John was filled with indignation and inquired, Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elias did? Jesus looked with pity upon his disciple and rebuked his harsh spirit, saying, The Son of Man is not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. How different from the spirit manifested by Christ is that of his professed vicar." I hope, dear listener, that you are still shielding your children, because the parental advisory has to be extended a little bit longer. You see, what Sister Charlotte was talking about in her testimony as a 16-year-old, in our day and in its modern form, that abuse of young people is still going on. And one of the main things that we see coming out of the Catholic Church in our times is the sexual abuse of young people. And what happens is that even though it's the physical component is heinous, repugnant, and repulsive, you see, friends, at the heart of it is that Satan does not want little children to have a foundation of spiritual things, so that they grow up abhorring those who are called pastors, priests, and so on, that associated with people who name the name of God is heinous acts like these. And we see that associated with the connection with the abuse of the priests is that they now have a generation of young people who don't want to go to church, who don't want anything to do with God, who say, forget God. Beloved, Satan does not do anything without a calculation. And so therefore, he'll have these young people shut up in these convent and monastery walls, away from everything that is human, that is life-giving. And just to be clear, notice the agenda playing out in our secular world with the quarantines and isolations. Not saying that for health reasons some of these things aren't good health-wise, but beloved, understand that Satan knows that if he could get these young people to hide themselves away behind these walls and to just commit themselves to the church, that they will be the next generation of heartless Jesuits, Illuminati, Freemason, and every other alphabet soup of pilgrims that the Roman Catholic Church has fostered in its warfare, in its counter-Reformation warfare against the Protestants. And you cannot be more heartless than having your integrity robbed from you from childhood. Beloved, understand, again, like I said, the Church of Rome is more repugnant than just its assault on the physical bodies of young people. It's going after the souls of men. It is seeking to put itself in the equation where Christ is. So could you imagine being that young and being robbed, and then in its place is the church. From morning till night, from night to morning, all you know is the church, and your service is to the church. One person in that video on Sister Charlotte rightly labels this a cult, but it's more than that. It is the right arm of the devil's strength. It's his representative here in the physical realm. And notice what we just read, how heinous acts could be performed by people who are heartless and not. Notice, again, friends, we talked about it the other day. I believe it was in yesterday's presentation, how the assault of Satan is manifested more against professed believers than people are out there. His assaults are on them the most. And so could you imagine a young boy, a young girl, wanting to love the Lord, and then they go inside these convents, these monasteries, and then they're subject to these acts, and it gets worse. I just recommend that you listen to that program, but please, please prepare to have your emotions go all over the place. I promise you that. You could go to the comment section of the video and you'll see the different testimonies of how people say that they could have only listened to it at one time, but their eyes were opened like nothing else to the atrocity that is the Roman Catholic Church. And for her, for the past almost 30 years, 40 years, to be putting on a face of, we're sorry, we did not mean to do this, we apologize for all things that were done in our name. But yet still, from that testimony, which was 30 years on now, this year, it's showing that, as we said in one of our previous readings, Rome does not change. It is the Protestant world that has, conformed, that has been reduced to a lapdog at the feet of the papacy. Beloved, that begins because people don't know. They don't know the Lord. They don't have a relationship with Him, and they're not reading His Word. Today, I challenge you. Don't find time to get into God's Word. Create the time. If you got to shuffle some things that don't really matter in your life, please do so. This is far more than any other thing that you could undertake in this world. As I was just saying, the Roman Church now presents a fair front to the world, covering with apologies her record of horrible cruelties. She has clothed herself in Christ-like garments, but she is unchanged. Every principle of the papacy that existed in past ages exists today. The doctrines devised in the darkest ages are still held. Let none deceive themselves. Let none deceive themselves. Let none deceive themselves. The papacy that Protestants are now so ready to honor is the same that ruled the world in the days of the Reformation, when men of God stood up at the peril of their lives to expose her iniquity. She possesses the same pride and arrogant assumption that lorded over kings and princes and claimed the prerogatives of God. Her spirit is no less cruel and despotic now than when she crushed out human liberty and slew the saints of the Most High. Beloved, some of these things I just don't want to comment on, because reading them in my history book, like I mentioned in a previous podcast, in my secular high school, I became more of a Christian than reading these things in this book growing up in the church. Because there in black and white were written how people feared going against the church, else they could not get married, they could not get buried, they couldn't have children. It's just awful. And yet today, well, again, despite the whole, you know, peace abuse things, Roman Catholicism is just seen as a regular, another part of the Christian community. And as we heard in our first audio, priest Anthony Palmer saying that Protestantism is dead and we're all Catholics again. If you have not listened to the whole video, I encourage you to listen to Anthony Palmer's video talking about that. Protestantism is dead. What a bunch of foolishness. God still has a people who are standing up to the tyranny of Rome. And if you're lying down and just asking for it, you know the image. I mean,